Tonight, I have the absolute pleasure to interview an absolutely amazing woman who, she's a gourmet plant-based chef. She was in the movie Plant Your Nation, and she's written probably my most favorite cookbooks out there, Plant Your Nation and Plant Your Kitchen. So if you don't know who this is Kim Campbell. So thank you so much, Kim, for agreeing to meet with me tonight.
Thank you, Jean. What a beautiful introduction. A gourmet chef.
You are. Because I absolutely love a lot of your recipes. The Italian dressing, I use that. That's a weekly thing. That's my dressing now. I have stopped looking and trying because I kept trying to find that elusive dressing, you know.
That's great. After you told me that, I started making it because that's not one that I pick out of the cookbook often. I have my other ones that are favorites, but I actually really enjoy that Italian too. It's real simple.
It is. And you have most of the stuff, you know, around. Mm-hmm. And I actually tried modifying it. I tried putting a little liquid smoke in there. No, don't do that.
Didn't work. Liquid smoke is one of those things that either makes a wow moment or it ruins it.
Don't do that. Don't add that to it. So I have to tell you, my husband and I we had recently gotten another one of our batches of the frozen food. And I love having it. We actually bought a separate little freezer to put in the basement just for these foods because we buy them by the 20 pack. And for me, it's awesome because like on Sunday, I batch cook and that takes me all the way through pretty much till Thursday or Friday. And then if I have a class or I'm doing something, an event, and I don't have time to cook on Friday night or whatever, I love these because I take them, I put them into the little tray, the warming tray, and I take it with me. I plug it in, like, wherever I'm going, and I have a hot meal. It's awesome. And the food, even my husband's like, wow, this is great, you know, because from the first batch that we've gotten through, it took us a while to go through them because you don't use them all the time, just kind of like an emergency kind of thing, so. Kudos to you on the food.
Well, and I love hearing that because the original plan behind these meals was to help people all over the country jumpstart into this. And we knew that if we went frozen, we could get it to a lot of people. But it's not just for jumpstarting. You just hit it beautifully. That's how Nelson and I use the food. In fact, he's downstairs right now eating one because I was busy all day and I'm busy now and busy tomorrow, so it's really nice to be able to pull those out of the freezer so that we don't fall off the wagon, and that's what we want for people that are going through the jumpstart. They have ongoing support with the meals, so I'm glad you're getting a chance to use those.
Oh, we do, and we use them traveling. Like, if we go out, you know, I'll pack ice around them, and, you know, we'll take them with us in a cooler, and then wherever we're going, usually there's a fridge, and they'll keep in there for days. And then we'll just pop them out. Or, like, if we're traveling, we've actually plugged them in the little heater tray into our car. And so, like, we'll stop and we'll take one of those trays and we'll split half and half and then keep going down the road. And then I'll pop another one in and, you know, in a couple of hours, we'll have another meal. Because we, like,
those Hot Logic machines are wonderful. Oh. They're like traveling crock pots. They're wonderful.
They are.
And, you know, even if you're not using them for frozen meals and you just heating up leftovers, they're great to have on hand. So I can't say enough great things about
them. Oh, absolutely. I found a dish that goes into it, you know, a Pyrex dish. I use that at work. And so I take my steel cutouts in the morning. So this works out perfect because I seal it into a glass dish and it goes into that and I heat it up. It stays contained in there, heats it up beautifully. So I have my steel cutouts. I like them warm. In the summertime, I'll eat them cold, but I like them warm generally most of the year. Then as soon as that's out, then I'll put my lunch in. So it works out amazing to heat up my food. So it's win-win. Yeah.
It is. We travel with it, too. We take them with us in the car and stop in at Wendy's and get our unsweetened tea and pull our little meals out. But it's just really convenient.
It is. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So one of the things that I've been doing is I have a Facebook group. We're doing 10-day challenges. We're basing it upon, you know, Dr. McDougall's Maximum Weight Loss book. So basically eating, you know, whole food plant-based, no flour, you know, no oils, obviously, you know, very low sugar, trying to minimize the amount of salt, you know. So, and I've got a mixed group of people in this, people that have been McDougaling for a while, or and just mm-hmm. need to lose some more weight, like me. I've hit a plateau and I still am trying to lose more. But there's also people that are new to this. So what advice can you help to a person to prepare their kitchen, you know, or just prepare themselves mentally? What advice? Right. 'Cause I know you've done a lot of these 10-day challenges.
The first thing I would tell somebody is don't think of this. It is a diet. I mean, that's the correct use of the word, but don't think of it as a diet, because diet means deprivation and it means people are starving and they're uncomfortable and they don't want to do this. When in fact, eating this way, you're satiated. You're eating mm-hmm. foods that you haven't eaten before. It's fun. It's exciting. Yes. It's new. And it's the things that people told us when they were doing jump starts is this is exciting. I never know what we're going to get for the next meal. And it was, because they had 20 different meals right. for 10 days. It was a lot of fun. But so that would be the first thing, is to don't set people up for the diet path right. because it's really need to be that. But look at this as an adventure, and then make a commitment and clean out the pantry and just get rid of all of those things that, you know, you were just talking about. Get rid of the oil, get rid of the excessive processed sugars and processed foods that have lots of oils and sugars and yeah. salts in them. And really make the commitment, because if you don't make the commitment, it's so easy to fall into that rut. I know, and I'm going to share this story. I'm going to share it reluctantly. But last Halloween, we were in Florida and we were in a neighborhood, and I love kids. And I thought, oh, this will be fun. You know, kids come to the door. And I went out and bought some probably not so healthy candy, but I wanted to see the kids and interact with the kids, and nobody came to the door. I think there were two trick-or-treaters, and we had this huge bowl of candy. And I should have practiced what I preach and just gotten rid of the candy, and it sat there for, gosh, a couple of weeks.
And every time you went by it.
Not really. I'm not a sweet hound, so if it was a bag of potato chips, it would have been much more enticing, but it was M&Ms. And one night, it was just kind of a bad day, and I grabbed one, and I thought, I just have one. It didn't stop there. It became two, and it became three. Yeah. If I had just gotten rid of them, so of course, I took a picture of all the empty bags. I think there were like six or seven, you know, those little
yes,
mini bags.
Yes, yes.
It was a temptation, and once I got started, I couldn't stop. Yes. I mean, I'm sure if I was a binge eater, it might have been the whole bowl. Sugar really bothers me, so my stomach was upset before I got to that point. But if your pantry is full of those temptations, you're going to fall into that trap, because we all do. And we all have days where we feel like, you know, we deserve it.
Right. I've been good.
It's not there.
I've been good for so long. I'm going to have a treat.
I deserve this. And how bad can it be? And, right. I went on the next day and didn't really give it another thought. But I think if you keep your pantries full of unhealthy food, it just becomes a pattern. And then pretty soon, two or three days in, you're just completely giving up on the plant-based. So really clean out the pantry, learn to read the labels, and commit to doing it, because you'll be a lot more successful that way. So, and then setting up your pantry and, you know, getting plenty of beans and grains and having flour, having condiments, things like mustards and vinegars, some sauces to season things with, you know, go right down through the cookbook. I've listed them all in the front of the cookbook, all those pantry items that really make cooking this way easy. And you don't have to go out and buy it all at once.
Right.
You can kind of work up to it. Sometimes it takes a few months to get to that point, but when you do, you'll look at your pantry and realize, wow, I can cook just about anything now.
Right. I know you've done a lot of these 10-day preparations or 10-day challenges. And one of the things that I know that I've seen in the movie, you know, Plant Your Nation, was you recommended that they do biometrics. So share with us some of the overviews of what you've seen of some of these changes from before to after.
Right. So we looked at our very first jump start. We did look at blood sugar. That can vary so much. And the trick with that is that, you know, you really have to do fasting, and it got complicated. We just looked at blood lipids, which is cholesterol, LDL, HDL, triglycerides. Right. And then we did a weight. And what we saw typically was for women, we're losing between 3 to 5 pounds. Mm-hmm. Men were losing more, between 6 to 8. It's not fair, but that's how it went.
Yes, yes.
And then the cholesterol, the overall reduction was about 20% mm-hmm. in total cholesterol.
Right.
But if people had very high cholesterols, we saw huge drops. people who had lower cholesterols, and I would say 170 to 180 for a typical American, they might have only went to 160 or 150. Right. But in my memory, I remember very well those people who were at 250 and up, mm-hmm. dropping 100 points, and it happened a few times, and it was just really, really inspiring to see that. In 10 days!
And one thing that I saw, even with myself, in switching to and following the maximum weight loss from Dr. McDougall, you're switching more to lower caloric density foods. And I, started increasing my greens and salads and consumption there, because I tend to be more like, I like the potatoes and the starch and, the bases there. But I was shifting more of what I was eating, and I saw a change in myself, the energy level. It's like, my day starts at like 6 o'clock in the morning, and I usually go to 11 o'clock or later every night. Well, and I'm changing my health destiny, I mean, I've gotten off a lot of medications. My husband reversed his MS. He had MS, mm-hmm. and I say had, because we haven't had him tested. We haven't done the MRIs or anything else, because I don't want to put him through that. What for? We have no mm-hmm. symptoms. It's gone. So mm-hmm. I'm just,
That's one.
Yeah. So that for us, there's no question. We're mm-hmm. we're in this for life. So mm-hmm. absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, what changes mm-hmm. do you see, within the body once you begin doing this?
Like I said, I think that people begin to lose weight, they begin to have more energy, they feel more connected to their environment and their food.
So I think
that's a mental health issue too. I think just the whole mind body spirit connection, I think people, and that's why people say, I don't cook, and I'm not going to change and start cooking plant based, but then they start to feel better, and they want that connection to their food.
Yes.
And they begin to become great cooks. And that's one of the philosophies we had behind Plant Pure Kitchen Starters, which is the dry line we have at Plant Pure Nation, because as people start to connect more with that food and they have that aha moment, we wanted them to be able to create meals but do a lot of the work for them.
Right.
So looking, adding the spices and some of the grains and, some of the things that people struggle with, and then all they had to do was get fresh produce, maybe add some liquids like a vinegar or milk, and have a meal.
And those are great for people that are just starting out this way, because a lot of people, and I run across this, it's like, I think people have forgotten how to cook.
They have. They have.
We've grown up with this microwave, which, I don't have a microwave. It's gone. I don't have it in my mm-hmm. kitchen. And I think people have just grown up and they're like, well, how do you heat that up? And I'm like, let me introduce you to the stove. Here's a pot. Let me introduce you to a pot, So I think that's one of the reasons why I make those cooking videos, is because people don't know how to cook anymore, and they don't realize how simple this is. And this does not have to be complex. That's one of the reasons why I like your recipes a lot, is they're very simple. They're very easy to make. There's not 12 steps, in this. They're pretty simple, mm-hmm. and I love them. One of the things we've noticed as we are starting to lose weight, and as you're burning fat, you're releasing some of the toxins. Some of these toxins, that 57 Chevy license plate, that are stored in the fat. Because your fat, I'm a chemistry teacher by day, so there's basically two kinds. There's fat soluble and water soluble. And if it's water soluble, you're peeing it out of your body. But if it's fat soluble, it's going into your fat. So toxins from the environmental, from personal care products, and from within the food itself. So as you're starting to burn fat, we've seen in our challenges, and I just wanted to ask you, if you had seen people having symptoms, and what have you seen?
That's a really interesting question, because Nelson took a lot of the calls on the first two jump starts, and I was behind the scenes cooking and cutting and chopping. He was taking calls from people going through the jump start, mm-hmm. and I said, we didn't have a lot of people that had some of these symptoms. And he said, you weren't really paying attention. You were too busy cooking the food. But we talked about this just recently, and they did. They had flu-like symptoms. Right. They just felt kind of nauseous. But it didn't last very long.
Right.
I mean, it was only a couple of days, and they started to feel a little bit better. But I think that the sicker you are, the worse your diet, the more likely you are to have some of these withdrawal kind of symptoms that you're describing. Have you seen a lot of people in your challenge have that?
Well, even like myself and Nancy, co-partner over in California, we actually made a little video clip with her because she's postmenopausal. She woke up one night with sweats, night sweats so bad. She soaked the bed and she got up, stripped the bed, went and took a shower, got back into bed, and had another episode so bad that she had to get up and do the whole process again. And even when she was going through menopause, she never had a reaction like that.
Like that.
So she was talking about that, and then the next day, it was like she had a massive headache, and, headaches were big ones that we've seen, pimples, rashes that have come out. So we've been recommending, for people going through this to drink lemon water, chamomile tea, if you're feeling nauseous, peppermint tea.
And drink, stay hydrated.
Yes.
It's really important to drink. We tell people to drink before every meal because a lot of times you're not as hungry as you are thirsty.
Right.
So if you can, you can get to the thirst first, and that also helps to kind of flush the toxins out of you as well.
Yes.
Yeah, and plenty of fiber, but we know the plant-based diet is all
about
fiber.
Oh, yeah.
We should have that discussion, too. Yeah.
Well, go ahead. Talk about it.
Well, when I do a cooking class, I always talk about it. Because it's one of those topics that women always, majority of the people that come to my classes are women, and they want to talk about this. And it's interesting that most people who are not plant-based think it's normal to go 2 or 3 days without having a bowel movement. And then you go plant-based, and you're now having one every day, sometimes twice a day.
Right.
And on some occasions, depending on what you eat, maybe 3 times a day
if
you're having something that's very, very, rich in fiber. For people to know that this is normal, it's healthy. And it's part of it. And I think as you're switching your diet over, you might even experience a little bit more of it. So it's just a normal, healthy part of being plant-based.
And gas. Always have that conversation. Don't forget that gas part.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. And I don't know. I mean, maybe we're just used to it. The winds blow in the Campbell house, but maybe we're just more used to it. And that's just more normal. I don't know, but, I'll take that over the other.
Oh, my gosh, yes. No, constipation, wow. No, not an issue in our household. Not an issue. Nope.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh. Some people are new to this way of life, and this one's a surprise to a lot of people when they start this, and it's the oil. And it's like, oh, my God, what about my triple cold press by virgins on the 7th solstice of the 7th month? Why isn't that good? I know. I mean, I heard about the Mediterranean diet, and isn't this great? And why? First of all, why no oil? But also, how do we cook or bake without this? Oh, my God. Can we do this? Can we survive?
Mm-hmm. Well, fat is one of the 6 nutrients, right? We have to have fat to survive.
Right.
But people have taken that to a new level. And there is fat in all plant foods.
Right.
So depend, some have more than others. Mm-hmm. But if you look at an oil bottle, and I always take an oil bottle to a class with me, and I show people the back, and there are no nutrients, no fiber, just calories, empty calories, calories with nothing in them. So you can take a beautiful stir fry and turn it into a nightmare by doing the EVOO thing. You know how they do that on the cooking channel, and they tell you to add a tablespoon, and they're putting about a cup in there. You can cook without it. It's very easy. That's also one of the tricks that I show people is how to dry saute, how to use water or wine or juices, anything. I usually use veg broth and water. That's pretty much what I use to dry saute. And you can caramelize onions beautifully without oil. I don't know why people think they need to use oil, but once they get away from it, they never go back.
Oh, no.
I think the last thing I gave up, and I don't know what your answer to this question is, but the last oil I gave up were the spray bottles.
Damn. Oh, my God.
And I'll tell you why it was the last thing I gave up, because I didn't want things to stick to my pan, and I didn't want to buy the parchment paper because it was expensive, mm-hmm. So, but I do use parchment paper, but I love those silicone pads.
Right.
And you can bake anything without it sticking. They have silicone muffin pans. They have silicone bread pans. You really just don't. But that was the last thing. And the only thing that I think I can't make, and I bet you have an answer to this because you're a wonderful cook, is I really struggle with my waffle iron.
Oh, that is my signature. That's my signature, is my potato waffles.
Really? Actually, and you don't have to use any spray or anything, and it doesn't stick to your waffle.
No, the key that I found, this is the key, is, and I use the Trader Joe's, the shredded hash browns, and what I do is I put them in water and rinse them, because I usually take them right out of the freezer. So I put them into hot water and just get the ice off of them and defrost them quick, like mm-hmm. Minute.
Oh, so you use the frozen ones.
I use the frozen ones. And then I take that and I put them into a pan and just get, put water on top of them and get them, so they're defrosted. Okay, fine. Then I rinse them, put them into a colander, and then I'll squeeze out as much, water as I can. Then I'll take those and put them into towels. And I'll put it in, and I'll roll it up, and I'll squeeze
out. Get it really
out.
Dry.
Yes. That is the secret, is to get these as dry as possible, get out them as most moisture as physically possible. And then once I do that, then I'll pick up I'll roll the towel up, and then I'll just literally just dump the towel into the bowl, and then I'll add whatever seasonings. Now, I like garlic. I like onion powder. I've been adding turmeric just to add that in there because turmeric is...
You put a little bit of nutritional yeast in there, too?
I've never been a big fan of the nutritional yeast. I don't care for the flavor that much. I don't know. I use it sometimes occasionally, but I'm not a big fan of nutritional yeast. So I like Berber seasoning. So I'll add some Berber, and I'll add turmeric just because turmeric's great for inflammation. So I'll mix that in there, and whatever seasonings, it could be anything. Because potatoes just, take on the flavor of anything. So then I'll stir that up, and then my potato griddle or waffle iron is heating up once it's ready. Then I'll just put the potatoes in, I'll spread them out.
That's the key, though. That's really important, what you just said.
Yes.
You have to heat it up. You have to get it really hot before you put it in. Same thing with your pans when you're dry sautéing. You have to get that pan good and hot before you put the onions in.
Yes.
If you just, if you put those potatoes in and it's cool,
right.
I think it's going to stick more.
Yes. And then I just bought, because I never had a waffle iron because I was never big, you drag it out once a year, you make waffles or something like that. But no, not anymore, because that is my new favorite friend. But I went and bought one at Bed Bath & Beyond, and it was, a Cuisinart. It has the plate, the trays pop out. So I pop it out and I put a plate over it, and then I flip it over. And it pops right out. Does not stick. No oil,
that's
nothing.
That's nicer than what I have then. Mine does not do that. I could actually make waffles in there better than I could potatoes, but it's kind of a sticking nightmare. So I'll have to try some of those tricks. But it sounds like, okay, I'm going to say what other people say to me. That sounds like a lot of work, Gene, to get all that moisture out, but it might be worth it because I love potatoes in the waffle iron.
Oh my god. And here's my next trick. I've learned this along the way. Once I get it out, I take scissors and I'll cut it in half, and then I pop it after it comes out of the toaster oven. It's nice and crispy, but I like crisp. Okay?
Yeah.
So I'll cut it in half with these, big cutting scissors. Mm-hmm. And then I'll pop it into the toaster oven, and I'll crisp it up. OMG. Literally.
Oh, that sounds good.
Literally, because it's crisping it on the outside. I mean, I pop it in like on my toaster oven where you make toast, it's like, the dark toast, the black toast. So it's mm-hmm. about 3/4 of the way in between half and black, the dark toast. Mm-hmm. So, and I'll crisp it up there. Sometimes I'll go through it once or twice because I really like it crisp. And they come out, literally, you can pick them up and eat them.
All right. Now I'm going to make these this week. I have to make these. That's
well, you have wonderful. To watch my video. I made a video on these.
Okay, I definitely will.
So,
yeah.
Okay.
But that was the last time I gave up on oil was the waffle iron. So we don't have any oil in the house, and I do have a bottle of oil that I do use for cooking classes as a prop.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So how can we bake without oil?
I think it's pretty easy to bake without oil. I do know that a cookie is not a cookie. It is a mookie, I call them, because, you know, when a traditional cookie has butter and white flour and sugar, and they all meld into each other, and that's why your cookie spreads out on the sheet. Mm-hmm. You know, if you don't expect that to happen, you're not going to be disappointed. And I tell people, cookies, at least in my world, a plant-based cookie is more like a muffin. Mm-hmm. It, you know, they're lighter, they're fluffier. I actually like them better. They're not quite as heavy and dense like a regular cookie. So we use things like bananas and applesauce or sweet potatoes. You can use, you know, silken tofu if you want, you know, whatever your preferences. There's a lot of different substitutions you can use for oil, but just know that it's going to taste a little bit different. It might be a little more dense. It might not melt, might not crisp around the edges. I think if people, they set themselves up for something that they think is going to be exactly like a traditional cookie or a traditional burger. I know I have veggie burgers, and they don't taste like hamburgers. The base is beans, and it's more of a patty.
Right.
But if you know that going into it, your expectations, you're going to bite into it, you're going to expect that.
Right.
So, I don't know. I think that sometimes we fool people into expecting something that they're not going to get.
Right.
I'm kind of getting away from the question, but I think that the substitutions, there's plenty of substitutions out there that I just mentioned, but just know that they do create different textures and mouthfeel. And there's some things that you can substitute and you would never know it. Drina Burton has a chocolate cake. You know about that chocolate cake, don't you?
Ooh, yes.
We all know about Drina's chocolate cake. It's amazing, and she uses sweet potatoes as her fat replacer. And I know that with dressings and sauces, I have used cashews as a fat replacer because there's plenty of fat in the cashew or a walnut. And sometimes you don't need very much, just a little bit to help emulsify all of the ingredients. And I think the trick is figuring out how much of those higher fat plant-based foods that you need. It's just don't have expectations that it's going to taste like the traditional cookie or the traditional burger or the traditional cake.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So do you have any other ideas that can help us to be successful on our 10-day challenge?
Yes. I would like to talk about snacks because we are a snacking culture.
Oh, yeah.
Time that we're 2 years old until the time that we're 53, which is what I am, we think we need to have snacks all day. And let's talk about it and figure out how we can navigate snacks because people are going to get hungry in between meals. And if I've cleaned out the pantry and I've taken all my chips and crackers out, what am I going to eat?
Right.
Coming up with some ideas like, you know, cutting up vegetables ahead of time and having them there, making plenty of dips. I made a dip really quickly today. It was just a hummus style dip, but having those things in your refrigerator, there's some great hummuses on the market that you can buy that have no added oil. Mm-hmm. Keeping your refrigerator full so that you don't get hungry.
Right.
I tend to snack, I make these chopped salads up ahead of time, thanks to Jill McKeever, who had a great video on making chopped salads, and I make these great big tubs of salad, and I eat that for a snack.
Mm-hmm.
And you wouldn't think a salad, you know, who's going to make a salad for a snack, but if you have it already made up, you can put it in a bowl and snack on it, and, having plenty of fruit. And we do spend a little more money on fruit, but we spend a lot less money on snack items that we used to have when, back in the old days. So I think it's really important to plan ahead and be thinking about those snack attacks. I don't know, Gene, do you have some suggestions for snacks that are, and a lot of people will say they need that crunch, that they need to have that crunchy texture.
Well, I like the snap peas. I like those a lot. I actually like peas, period. At Trader Joe's, I get these bags of the English peas. And I'll just sit there and eat them like I would peanuts,
Yeah.
And they're very filling, very bulky, great to fill you up, and you don't even think about it. Of course, the celery, carrots, those kinds of things, I have those all the time. But I also like green beans, just to eat those raw. And I'll cut those up and have those, and I put them in containers. On Sundays, my day for batch cooking and chopping, shop, chop, and prep. That's Sunday for me. And that pretty much takes me through most of the week. I mean, you can't do everything. Like, kale only stays, like, you know, for me, like, 1 or 2 days. So I make kale enough for 2 days for my husband and I. We steam it, and we put the balsamic vima and paws, the balsamic vinegar on top of that. That's awesome. You know, those are things that, and like the hummus, having those things, you know, to be able to dip into something and have that there.
I like to roast chickpeas.
That's a good one.
In the oven, and I cook them forever until they're really crispy. I probably overcook them, but that's how we like them.
Well, low temperatures for a longer period of time makes them crunchy, because there's that fine line between and, you know, burnt. Yes.
But, you know, you can't talk me out of it. If it's, you know, 8 o'clock at night and we've had dinner and we're sitting and visiting, reading a book, watching TV, and I decide I've got to have something sweet, and it's not every night I have this attack, but when I decide that I've got to have something to sweet, look out. I'm going to find it.
Yeah, you're right.
So I'm prepared for that. I have, I freeze bananas. Mm-hmm. I have lots of frozen fruit that Trader Joe's has a great deal on frozen fruit.
Yes.
And I put them in the blender and I make that ice cream that I've just got to have. Right. I put a little bit of cocoa powder in it. But being prepared, because you know that when you get that craving, when you want something sweet, you're going to figure out a way to do it. So stocking up on the healthy stuff.
Yes.
And not having the junk around. Because if I have that dark chocolate candy bar that's supposedly healthy, I'm
going
to eat it. So I tend not to buy those. Once in a while, we'll get them for a treat. But I know what happens when they're in the cupboard.
Well, thank you so much, Kim. I really appreciate your time. You're amazing. This is great.
We can always find things to talk about.
This is true.
Yeah.
Well, thank you again.
Thank you, Jean.